والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل
وكل في فلك يسبحون
ويخلق ما لا تعلمون.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to a new episode of our program, The Universal Quran. We talked before about a few verses of Surah Al-Insan, and we talked about the meaning, and we gave some examples and some reports, some traditions about the verses of remembrance or mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the verses that preceded this verse as well. And today, inshallah, we are going to talk about verse number 28 and a few verses that will come after. The verse here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَاسْجُدُ لَهُ وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. Part of the night, prostrate for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then during the night as well, you will glorify you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as much as you can. So the prayer during the night while people are asleep is one of the customs of the pious people. When the Prophet ﷺ was told about how to go to paradise, he said اطعام الطعام وإفشاء السلام والصلاة بالليل والناس نيام. If you want to be admitted to paradise, to go to paradise, you have three keys. The first one is to feed the poor, and the second thing is to spread or say salamu alaykum to those who you know and those who you do not know. And then the third thing is to pray during the night while people are asleep. And we have another hadith, the hadith sahih, some hadith in which the Prophet says, ينزل ربنا جل وعلا إلى السماء الدنيا في الثلث الأخير من الليل فيقول هل من تائب فأغفر له، هل من تائب فأتوب عليه، هل مستغفر فأغفر له، هل من سائل فأعطيه، هل من كذا هل من كذا. الله سبحانه وتعالى the Prophet reported that during the last third of night Allah سبحانه وتعالى comes to our heavens in a way which is due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى and which is suitable for him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a way that we can't imagine, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says in Surah Ash-Shura, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing which is equal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't say how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, descends down, or how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to our heavens, for example, or our sky. No, this is something which is mainly rested with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, for example, as he says in Surah Al-Fath, يَدُ اللَّهِ فَوْقَ أَيْدِيهِمْ. So you can't give an exact description to such hand, but just you understand it as it is. It is something that can't be imitated and can't be compared to the hands of human beings. But we just understand that it's the hand, but you can't make it equal to human beings, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. So he says, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَاسْجُدْ لَهُ وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talked about the reward of the people or what they will find in paradise, as he says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ. No soul would know what's kept hidden for them. Before this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, تَتَجَافَى جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا. So they leave their beds. They don't sleep for a lot of time. We have a report about Sayyidina Umar bin Khattab رضي الله عنه. One day, a man came to him during the, it was in the middle of the day, and he knocked the door and he said to Sayyidina Umar, I thought that you are asleep. Sayyidina Umar said to him, if I sleep during the day, then my ummah will be destroyed. And if I sleep during the night, Umar ibn Khattab رضي الله عنه himself will be destroyed. Means he doesn't leave the night prayer. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, if somebody, for example, wakes up during the night and he makes wudu and he offers two rak'ahs, then he will have a great reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the devil will find no way to seduce him and to, for example, try to misguide him and so on. And also in Surah Al-Dhariyat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about the believers, he said, كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ. They didn't sleep a lot. During the some parts of the night, they used to wake up and pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the beginning of Surah Al-Muzzammil, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلْ, one of the names of the Prophet ﷺ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُمِ اللَّيْلَ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Try to pray during the night, most of the night, or most of such time in which you can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in the same surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلَمُوا أَنَّكَ تَقُومُ أَدْنَ مِنْ ثُلُثَيْ اللَّيْلِ وَنِصْفَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows very well that you pray during the night. So this is one of the secrets by which you can have a very strong relation. It's a kind of connection. Remember that all people are asleep, and you wake up alone, you pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you make sincere dua, you make sincere prayer for him. There are some times in which the dua could be accepted, and one of these times is during the night, when pray alone, and you pray with sincerity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one of the characteristics of the believers, that they, like Imam al-Hasan al-Basri, unlike the great ascetic and the great pious predecessors, it was their habit, or it was one of their customs. Some of them, during the month of Ramadan, as Imam Shafi, I think, said that, and Abdullah ibn, or the son of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said that his father used to finish reading the Quran in 7 days, and in another narration he said that he used to finish reading the Quran in 3 days. So this is the month now in which you can pray a lot during the night. If you can make qiyam, this is one of the things that you can do, is to revive the sunnah of the Prophet. The Prophet ﷺ used to pray a lot during the time, to the extent that his feet were swollen, or were, and then Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked him, O Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why should you do all of that? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven your past and future sins. And he said, I would like to be a thankful worshiper to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I would like to be a thankful person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his blessings. وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَاسْجُدْ لَهُ وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. So prayer during the night will have a great reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I said, it is one of the features of the believers, that once they wake up during the night, the first thing, unfortunately, some people now, when they wake up during the night, the first thing, they go to their computer. They turn the computer on and they spend a lot of time. Or some of them go for cafes, for example. Or some others go to watch some films and some programs. But the nature or the habit, the custom of the good believer should be like that. Once you wake up, the first thing you do is to make wudu. And then the second thing is to pray for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he says here, وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَسْجُدْ لَهُ وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. Prostrate for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask him for his forgiveness. Ask him for his pleasures. Ask him for provision. Ask him for anything you want. And of course, if you are sincere in your dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to your call, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill your request. As you are quite sure that he will respond to your call. As the Prophet ﷺ said, أُدْعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَنْتُمْ مُوقِنُونَ بِالْإِجَابَةِ. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make your prayer, make your dua, but be sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to your call and will fulfill your requests. وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. And another issue is the issue of tasbih. What does mean tasbih? Does it mean to have a rosary bed and you say, as some people, as some dervish say, subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah? It's not like that. It doesn't mean that at all. Subhanallah means you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond all attributes that human beings have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is over all his creatures, is over all the universe, is over all humanity, all rulers, all kings, sultans, all these things, because he created all of them. So subhanallah, as We just said the example of Sayyidina Sulaiman, and one day Sayyidina Sulaiman, subhanAllah, he was passing, and they were going to make Salatul Istisqa, or asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for irrigation. And while he was going, he found a very little ant asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the same thing. She said, "Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't punish us by the sins of human beings, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower us with water so we can drink and we can have food and so on." And then subhanAllah, Sayyidina Sulaiman said to his followers, "Go back to your homes because you have been irrigated, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you water because of the dua of this little creature. Irji'u faqad suqitum bidu'ai ghayrikum kama qala alayhi salam." So the issue of tasbih, saying subhanallah, means that you are quite sure that nobody else, for example, worth worshipping, nobody else worth glorifying, nobody else worth remembering, nobody else worth mentioning except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said the word tasbih in many verses. Sometimes it came in the form of presence. Present simple, present tense. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, for example, in Surah Al-Jum'ah, يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدِ. And then in Surah Al-Taghabun, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And then in Surah Al-Hadid, the iron, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ. And in another Surah Al-Ahzab, وَسَبِّحُوهُ. It's here in the issue or in the form of a command. So tasbih came in the form of the past, and in the form of the present, and in the form of the command, all of which indicate only one thing, all of which indicate that tasbih sometimes is coming as a form of an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَسَبِّحُ لَيْلًا تَوِيلًا means spend the most of the night making tasbih for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, tasbih, what some people understand, just they understand Islam that it is the religion of just saying some sentences and some words, but in reality, you need to understand what do these words mean. What do these tasabih or tasbih, for example, mean? You need to understand every word you say. You need to understand if you are making tasbih, if you are making prayer, if you are making dua, what every single word you know sometimes. Because in order to understand the essence and the message of Islam, you need to understand that very well. وَمِنَ اللَّيْلِ فَاسْجُدْ لَهُ وَسَبِّحْهُ لَيْلًا طَوِيلًا. And that was the custom of the Prophet ﷺ. As we mentioned the hadith before, he said that people will regret for only one thing, for even or for every single minute, for every single hour that passed in their life and they didn't mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any gathering, any meeting, any place in which you didn't mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you will regret in the day of judgment.
Trying to get together, but all their efforts were in vain because of ignoring or turning away from this great foundation. We see many people coming to the way of truth, following the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but later on they get off track. What is the reason behind that? Unity is a result, it's not a cover-up. We have to be united from inside. And Allah made this clear in the Quran when He said, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you these things just to be ready, just to get involved in the issue of tasbih, in the issue of dhikr, in the issue of mentioning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be in the state of purity all the time, to be in the state of connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He loves you, as He said in the holy hadith that we said before, and we remind you again with it, and I remind myself first, وَمَا زَلَ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَبُ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ فَإِذَا أَحْبَبْتَهُ كنت سمعه الذي يسمع به وبصره الذي يبصر به ويده التي يبطش بها إلى آخره until the end of the hadith. So Allah says here, my worshiper is still trying to come closer to me by additional prayers and until I love him. So if I love him, then I will be his hands by which he can grasp, I will be his legs by which he can walk, and I will be his ears by which he can listen to, or he could hear. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, then you have got the greatest pleasure and you have got the greatest reward. But how can you make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love you? Is by loving the Prophet ﷺ and following the Prophet ﷺ himself, as Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. If you indeed love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, follow me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will follow you. And then the next verse, verse number 27, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the surah is moving to another group of people. The verse here says, إِنَّ هَؤُلَا يُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ. As to those people, the disbelievers, as Ibn Kathir and Imam al-Tabari said, the verse here refers to the disbelievers. يحبون العجلة, they love the fleeting life and put away behind them a day that will be hard. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking here about the disbelievers, and he said that their main concern is loving this fleeting, this vanishing, this disappearing life. And he said also in another surah, in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَلَتَجْدَنَّهُمْ أَحْرَصَ النَّاسِ عَلَى حَيَاتٍ. You would find them among the people who are eager or who love this life more than anything else. So the verse here is trying to undermine the issue of dunya or the value of dunya. It is valueless and it has no value at all. As we know the hadith of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in which he says, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ in which he says, لو أن الدنيا, the meaning of the hadith, تساوي عند الله جناح بعوضة ما سقى الكافر منها جرعة ماء. If this dunya, this life worth a single or the weight of a wing of a mosquito, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't give the disbeliever even just a single amount or a mouthful amount of water, or will not give him means by which he can get water. So, subhanAllah, sometimes I ask myself, and I feel amazed at the people who have nothing to do. They just kill, they just deserve, steal, backbite. They involve in many immoral things, and they do their best to, subhanAllah, to commit themselves to this dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the holy hadith, يَا دُنْيَا مَنْ خَدَمَنَا فَخْدِمِيهِ وَمَنْ خَدَمَكِ فَاسْتَخْدِمِيهِ. The one who loves us, the one who serves us, O dunya, be subject to him and be servant to him. But if he serves you as dunya, then you use him and you do your best to humiliate him and to cause him difficulties and to cause him hardships and so on. So the dunya, as the Prophet ﷺ, he said that the dunya is nothing. And he said, my example and this life is only like one person who was traveling, and then he found a tree, and then he stayed for a short time, and then he went away. مَا أَنَا وَالدُّنْيَا إِلَّا كَرَاكِبٍ إِسْتَضَلَّ بِشَجَرَةٍ ثُمَّ تَرَكَهَا. This is the example. So this life, the dunya itself, the fleeting life or the vanishing life is short. Even if you are going to live for 100, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, when he compared the views or the scene that the people will see on the Day of Judgment, he said in the last verse in Surah An-Nazi'at, كَأَنَّهُمْ يَوْمَ يَرَوْنَهَا لَمْ يَذْبَثُوا إِلَّا عَشِيَّةً أَوْ دُحَاهَا. Even if somebody lived for 100 years, when he would see the great things on the Day of Judgment that might make the person, that might make the little boy, his hair will be gray, for example, and a lady might miscarry her baby. It is valueless and it has no value for the worshippers, for the people. They just use it as a bridge. It is just like an exam. You study well for the exam and then you will pass the test. If you don't study, of course you will fail and you will never be able to pass the test. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disapproved love of this life, and I'm not quite sure whether it is a hadith or a saying, but it says, حُبُّ الدُّنْيَا رَأْسُ كُلُّ خَطِيئَةٍ. Loving this life is the main cause behind all evils. So those who love this life and leave a horrible day behind them, then they are not good believers. Because the believer, he thinks that this life is short and it has no value at all. As great companions like Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Abu Bakr and all of them, of course, they thought or they were quite sure that this dunya equals nothing. It was reported that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment would say to this life, go dunya, you are nothing. So it is just a way by which you can collect rewards, by which you can gain loads of good things and just make your record full of good deeds. But after that, then you have a great day. And again, even if the life was quite long for you, the Day of Judgment, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verse we have just mentioned in Surah Nazaat, then you will imagine that although you have stayed for a long time, but when you say the horrible things or the horror or the Day of Judgment, which would make people feel as if they are drunk, and which make, for example, a lady, if she is pregnant, she will miscarry her pregnancy because it is something horrible or something terrifying that we have never seen before. Imagine that you see these huge mountains are going to be reduced to mere ashes. They will be nothing. Skyscrapers, towers, buildings, all of which will be turned to nothing and will be smashed, will be destroyed. And graves will come out with the dead people. And for example, skies will fall down. So it is something that you can't imagine. A little example, when we face something like earthquake. Look at the situation of people when there is an earthquake. They try to run. Everybody is trying to escape. Everybody, for example, a lady might leave her son, might leave her daughter, and the father might leave his family. Everybody wants to escape, to save his life first. So if it is something small like that, how about the hereafter, about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave many names, and about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned us in many occasions and in many different verses, just to be warned and to be ready for that day. So they love this life, and then they leave behind them a very difficult day. A day, if somebody has prepared very well and has done loads of things for that day, then he is going to be a winner. He is going to be admitted to paradise, and he will have no problem at all because he listened to the message of Islam, and he listened to the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ. He believed in the Prophet. He believed in all revealed books and so on. And he acted according to the instructions of Islam. But on the other hand, if somebody, for example, he loved this life, he committed himself mainly to collect money, to be a worshipper of money. As the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the seventh hadith, تَعِسَ عَبْدُ الدِّنَارُ وَالدِّرْهَمُ, the one who worships money and nothing else, he is an unhappy person and he will not be in the safe side. But your main, and you have no other Lord except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Money or positions or anything you have in this life are just means by which you can get a good life, by which you can overcome some problems. But they are not the main thing, because the money is something that decreases and increases, as we stated before. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us to be ready for that day and to not be committed to this life, and don't make dunya your main concern and your own business, but think about the hereafter. The dunya is just a place which will lead you to the hereafter. If that place was good here, you have done many good things, then be happy for your future life. If you haven't done anything good, then you blame nobody, but you blame yourself. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who love the hereafter more than loving this dunya, and to make dunya as just one of the ways that will lead all of us, inshallah, to paradise and to the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for the believers. At the end, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all of us and to forgive all our sins. And at the end, I leave you in the safety and protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Until we meet again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
وترى الجبال تحسبها جامدة وهي تمر مر السحاب صنع الله الذي أتقن كل شيء إنه خبير بما تفعلون
مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله سبيل الله كمثل حبة أنبتت سبع سنابل
وكل في فلك يسبحون
ويخرج